how important is it that we get foreign expertise into the US to continue with a supply chain that has proven to be broken on previous mines of, what, 2 or 3 years ago?
Yeah, Caroline, good morning. You know, the value to the U.S. of having more domestic manufacturing at the leading edge or close to the leading edge of semiconductors is strategically pretty important, right? We are all looking at geopolitical instabilities and risks, particularly in the Asia Pacific. And so this builds on Taiwan Semi's ability to spread their manufacturing around the world. They already have announced plans in Japan and Germany for lagging edge manufacturing. They already have operations here in the US, but really, really limited. This will bring to the US a significant portion of some manufacturing close to the leading edge by the time it's done. And that'll help stabilize things. It also de-risks Taiwan Semi a little bit for investors.
Okay. De-risk to a certain degree. What's been interesting is other companies, when coming into the United States wanting to boost their manufacturing, have worried about the limitation on labor. Have we got the right, ultimately, rest of the joined up approach here? Yes, you can get the money, you can get the grants and the loans, but have you got the talent pool?
Yeah, it's a real challenge. So when I was working up at Albany Nanotech as part of the team there that was trying to bring manufacturing to upstate New York, and there wasn't much beyond IBM in the Hudson Valley, we had to invest in the local industrial infrastructure, if you like, not just labor, but also machine shops and other support to a fabrication facility. Intel is going to face those challenges in Ohio because there's very little infrastructure there in this area. Mm-hmm. Taiwan Semi at least already has plenty of operations in Phoenix, and they're going to have to do more. And so training programs in conjunction with local technical colleges and community colleges help to create that funnel. Fortunately, chip fabrication plants tend to be very capital intensive. It's not a lot of labor that ends up getting hired here. So these subsidies aren't really about creating jobs, although you'll hear other politicians say that. Probably most of the jobs are in the construction of the plant itself. Once the plant is up and running, you know, maybe 1,000 or 2 people. So it's not a huge number, and I know people are focused on this concern about labor, but we do have great engineering schools in this country. Yeah. And once the job opportunities are there, you tend to see more kids flow into those programs. Plus you add in the customized training programs from the companies.
Okay, so the companies, when we think of TSMC being one that is really making the most of subsidies, loans, grants being offered, so too is Intel as well. And I'm just interested as to how much you think this money, this CHIPS Act, will be filtering into foreign entities or indeed more local US presence.
Well, you know, the leading edge in manufacturing, unfortunately for the US companies, has been taken over by Taiwan Semi and Samsung. Intel had made some mistakes in their planning for manufacturing design. They chose a path that ultimately didn't work out very well, and now Pat Gelsinger is trying to shift that path to the more modern alternative, and it's going to take them some years and it's going to be costly. So in terms of the U.S. strategic goal of creating more supply of chip manufacturing in this country, we have no choice but to include foreign companies like Taiwan Semi and Samsung. We will see if Intel ultimately is successful in bringing their manufacturing up to snuff. But right now, they're trailing edge.
Move it on and consider for us, JoAnne, ultimately whether or not, you say it takes some of the risk out for investors, does it really take the risk out of supply chain concerns going into the next 10, 20 years that we've seen that hit so hard during COVID?
No. Caroline, I think you asked that question deliberately to get a no answer. I mean, there is just a global integration of manufacturing, not just in chips, but, you know, as we saw during COVID, also in protective clothing and devices. And we don't ever really want to undo that. We value incredibly and benefit incredibly from trade and having countries specialize in manufacturing the things that their comparative advantage favors. And we get cheaper goods because of it. Consumers benefit around the world because of that that separation of production by specialty. So we don't ever want to undo trade flows, right? But what we want to do is shore up the infrastructure of politics and economics, hopefully to keep disruptions to supply chains as low as we can. Now, obviously, COVID or something like that, another pandemic comes along, and we're going to have problems. And so we have tried to onshore more production of critical items. And that's what the CHIPS Act is all about.
What's been interesting is there's been, for example, Bloomberg Intelligence saying, look, ASML, chip equipment maker, is likely to be another key player that benefits from some of the grants, the loans, the support, the subsidies that the US government currently has. Any other key players that come to mind?
Well, yeah, I think that's right to point out the equipment guys. The more chip fabrication facilities that are built, the better it is for Lam Research, for Applied Materials, for ASML, KLA, you know, all the chip guys and all the gas suppliers and the other smaller equipment suppliers like, say, Aveco Instruments. You know, there's a lot of beneficiaries. This is a very large industry. And so it's pretty broad. And also the companies that use these manufacturers, NVIDIA, AMD, Apple, they all benefit by having a source of supply that's more globally diversified and therefore less subject to geopolitical risks.